Plato's most famous doctrine is that of the forms, and it's also his most infamous. What makes it so difficult? Let's consider. Hello, philosophers. I'm Chico. Welcome to the Philosopher Show, where we consider the greatest questions of human history. Recently in this playlist, we've been looking at Plato's doctrine of the forms, and we're in his dialogue, The Parmenides, talking about challenges to this doctrine. Now, Plato introduced his idea of the forms to explain a few different phenomena, and these forms are philosophical mechanisms. They're concepts that work in a specific way, kind of like a machine, to explain things that we see in the world. Now, in this playlist, we've gotten to the point where we're just refining this mechanism. So today is going to be a little bit more of a technical exercise. And at the end, we're going to see just how viable this mechanism is. So it's not going to be the most exciting of episodes, but I'm going to do my best to explain it in a way that makes it very understandable and at least a little interesting. Now, remember that the forms explain certain phenomena about the world, like predication. And the thing about the forms that explains it is self-predication. So why is a predicate true of a thing? For example, the predicate green could be true of a statue. The statue isn't greenness itself, it's a statue. And yet, the statue is green is true. So how's that possible? Plato says it must be related to the form of greenness, greenness itself. There must be this form of greenness, and the statue partakes in that greenness. So we have two different kinds of things here. Self-predication, the form is the property, and predication, the particular thing partakes of the property. And this explanation of predication goes further to explain attribute agreement. So we ask the further question, how is it the case that the plant is green is a true statement? And same thing, there must be this form of green, this greenness that the plant partakes in. But wait a second, the plant partakes in green, the statue partakes in green, must be the same green. It must be the same form. If not, if they're different forms, then they're not both green. The whole point is the form is greenness itself. That being greenness explains how other things can be green by that partaking relation. But now a problem arises. Here's what it sounds like we've said. If there is a case of attribute agreement, if two things have the same attribute, like green, then there must be a form separate from those two things that explains this attribute agreement through the self-predication. How is it that a statue is green and a plant is green? They both share the same form of greenness. But now self-predication ensures an additional attribute agreement between the form of greenness and the different things that partake in green. But wait a second, by one and two, isn't it the case that we need a new form to explain this new attribute agreement? There's a green statue, the green plant, the form of greenness. Now we need a second form to explain how they're all partaking in green. But wait a second, this new form is also going to have that same problem. We're also going to have attribute agreement between those two green things, the form of green, our new form of green. We're going to need another form to explain that. And we're going to have to keep on going all the way ad infinitum. This is a problem called the third man argument. Now, some philosophers think that we can just accept the fact that there are an infinite number of forms for each predicate that we have. We have green statue, we have green plant, that means there's the form of green, now we need a new form of green, now we need a new form of green, and they say, yeah, so what, man? Remember what we said last time? Hey, we're already trying to explain weird things. But then again, that doesn't really give us license to just start believing whatever weird stuff that we want to. The whole point that Socrates has in this dialogue is to explain these many things by one thing. We're explaining the plant is green, the statue is green, by this one thing, green. But now all of a sudden, we're explaining the many things by an infinite number of things. And that seems to be totally contrary to the whole project in the first place. Another problem here is that it seems like we're describing a causal relation. What causes the plant and the statue to both be green? The form of greenness. But now a form of greenness needs to be caused to be green by this additional form. And that additional form needs to be caused for the greenness by another additional form. It seems like nothing's actually going to get caused in the first place. You know, if all we were worried about was an explanation, then you can use one thing to explain another thing without getting into this infinite regressive explanations. But if we're talking about causes, a cause can't produce an effect until that cause actually exists. So if all we have is an infinite series of things that need themselves to be caused, nothing's actually going to be caused in the first place. Now, one possible solution we can have here is to reject this idea of self-predication. And we saw in a previous video, what are we talking about when we say the form of greenness itself anyway? That thing can't be green because it's not a physical thing. Or maybe better yet, instead of saying that, we could say that self-predication is a little bit different than regular predication. When objects partake in a form, they in some way express the property that that form is. So they partake in the form of greenness and they become that color green. But maybe when we say self-predication, we say the form of greenness is itself green. We don't mean that it expresses that property of green in some way. What do we mean? I have a hard time understanding what we could mean. So I'm not really sure if this option's even going to work in the first place. So here's a third challenge for Platonists. Explain the difference between predication and self-predication in a way that makes sense. Partaking would be the normal way of having a property. The property manifests itself to our senses in that way. But the relation being would be a more intimate way of having a property. The property wouldn't manifest itself. Instead, the form would just be that thing. Being would be a different way of relating to that property. The form would be itself that property, and yet somehow would not manifest that property. Can we make sense of that? I don't know. Now, in the dialogue of the Parmenides, two possible options are presented and rejected. We won't go into them right now because we're going to get them later in the playlist. But I will go through one last objection the Parmenides gives to Socrates. Now, I didn't come up with his example. I'm going to use it because Parmenides used it. So just bear with me on this one. Imagine a group of slaves, Ed, Jerry, and Donatello. Now, Ed, Jerry, and Donatello all share that property of being slaves. But slaves to whom? It's going to have to be to a specific person. Let's say Anita. But what they won't be slaves to is to the form of master. They'll be slaves to an actual master. And the form that they partake in of slavery can't be a slave to Anita herself. It would have to be a slave to the form of mastery. So particulars like Ed, Jerry, Donatello are related to other particulars like Anita. Forms like slavery are related to other forms like mastery. But now it looks like we have two totally disconnected realms. We have the forms relating to each other. We have the particulars relating to each other. How do the two worlds relate? Worse yet, one of the reasons that Plato posits the forms is to explain our knowledge of universals. But if these two worlds are totally unrelated, then what is it that we know when we know about particular things? So here's one more challenge that we have for this doctrine of the forms. We're going to have to explain how these two seemingly unrelated worlds actually do relate in a way that the forms cause the particulars to have the properties that they do and cause us to know the things that we know about those particulars. One of the great things about the masterworks in philosophy and in all classic literature, it takes way too much time to exhaust all your knowledge that's possible of those works. That's all I'm going to present about Plato, for right now at least. My plan is to go into Aristotle, but eventually come back and maybe present some extra stuff about Plato. And you have specific questions that you got from maybe your philosophy class or from reading your Plato, then please hit me up in the comments and I'd love to answer any of those questions and make extra videos that will help you to understand those things. And if you have a friend that's in class with you whom you think this video might help, please tag them in the comments. That would be really cool. Adios.